Hello and welcome to the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, episode 238, Playing Favorites, dealing with board game nepotism.
Tonight we're tackling an interesting question about dealing with people playing favorites at the game table. We'll also be talking about the games we played this week, including Stool Pigeon, Distilled with the Cask Strength Expansion, the Artemis Project with Satellites and Commanders Expansion, and tons more. Plus, we've got three full reviews for you tonight, including Marvel Dice Throne, Xylotar, and Kiss the Goblin.
It was a good week in gaming.
Well, before we get to that, some introductions. I'm Sean, your host, and here with me we have the Tabletop Bellhop Wizard, Deanna.
Hey, folks.
And the Tabletop Bellhop himself, Mo T.
I am Mo Tuzano, the Tabletop Bellhop, your cardboard concierge, helping you make your game nights better. Thank you, Grand Gamers Guild, for sponsoring this episode.
Show up Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern at twitch.tv/tabletopbellhop to watch us record this podcast live. Find links to games and other things we mentioned tonight at tabletopbellhop.com/episode238. That's 238. Links included maybe affiliate links, which cost you nothing at all to use, but help us make content. Furthermore, as a board game podcast, we often receive review copies of games. Most games mentioned tonight fall under this category. Well, we're here to answer your gaming and game night questions.
Send your gaming and game night questions to questions@tabletopbellhop.com or head over to our website and click on Ask the Bellhop.
Or if you're here live, feel free to put them into the lobby, our chat room here on Twitch.
Well, tonight's question comes from Perpetual Ploy. They ask, how do you handle board game nepotism? My group has three couples, so we are always looking for advice. They remind us that games break down if leaders aren't targeted. Not to let people sit by each other, removing the ability of couples to take two turns without others influencing the game. And including group and peer pressure to jeer at them for shady moves. Their personal board game motto is, play to win. Every move you make should be better to your better your position, objective, or result, despite personal relationships. They say my spouse learned quickly that I don't pull punches in games.
Okay, so my first thought when Mo read me the question and said this is what we're going to be talking about this week, I'm like, this is a problem. It's never even occurred to me. Apparently, it never occurred to me to be extra nice or extra mean to Mo when we're playing. Or my kids. I don't pull punches with my kids either. I tell them that up front. I'm like, nope, you're in for a ride, guys.
Yep.
But that said, I have definitely seen it with other people, especially at our public play events. I will say our regular game group is pretty good about it. Though even with when we had our old Monday night group, now and then there'd be a few things where people would hold grudges from one game into the next, which is also a symptom of this, because honestly, this problem to me is not exclusive to couples. It could be friends, enemies, and basically any time something from outside the game influences a decision in the game. To me, that can be a problem. It's a potential problem. No. Like I've definitely played.
So I also want to point out a very human problem that can lead to this kind of behavior sometimes. And that is that people are really, really bad at being random, just absolutely horrible at it. Like there is all sorts of science to support the fact that you are not able to be random. So either focusing on or avoiding people often feels like a better solution than picking on everyone in turn or trying to pick randomly. Often it feels like doing something to the person that you know best may even be the safest solution. After all, you can always make it up to them later rather than making a stranger feel awkward or risk antagonizing them. And a lot of us don't like to, make it feel like someone's going to be angry at us. We're trying to reduce conflict.
Okay, yeah. I never thought of that before, and now I'm going to be feeling paranoid about it next time I'm playing with strangers. I'm like, oh, wait.
So I don't know. Maybe it's just me, but it could just because I host a lot of public play events and I play with a lot more strangers than the two of you often do. But I've definitely seen this being a problem where two good friends will sit down at the table together playing. I'm going to use Catan as an example because it's one where this I've seen it happen the most often, where the couple at the table, friends, partners, whatever it happens to be, won't play the robber on each other because they don't want any bad feelings for later in the night, perhaps, or they don't want to seem like they don't want to, again, like you were saying, have bad conflict with someone they don't know, or favorable trades. Like, I have definitely sat at a table where I'm like, had a couple there and go, I'll give you one rock and you give me three wheat and three rocks so I can build a city. And they're like, sure, here you go. And everyone else at the table is like, what are you doing? Like, what the heck? You just gave them a free city. Other examples in other games are when someone does have to attack a point later. It's like, you can steal space. You can steal 2 points from any other player at the table, and they steal it from the player who's in dead last because it's their sister or their sibling or another personal person in their family.
Okay,
I've seen it where it goes the opposite way, where, okay, if you get a thing, you have to help someone else out. And instead of helping, you know, the person who's in last or the person who's doing badly or the person that could use the help the most, they give the point leader even more points and increase the spread because they want to be nice to the person at the table.
Okay. I got into this argument earlier with you when we first started talking about this. I feel like, yes, okay, it's not good if they're doing it because they're trying to be extra nice to someone at the table. But I will say sometimes people are not necessarily aware of who the point leader is. Yep. Not everyone is always cognizant of that, and getting mad at them for it isn't always fair.
No, I agree. It's more when it's a big obvious. I'm not saying you have to be counting all the cards or that you have to always attack the point leader and you have to know who the point leader is. But it's often very obvious when there is someone who is not doing well. And it's also possible that personal feelings are getting in the way, and people target other people for reasons that have nothing to do with the game that's going on. I've definitely played a game where everyone targeted one person because they didn't like them, or they did like them and they're joshing with them and everyone thought it was funny to beat up on that one person. Now, the other thing I did want to point out is that this isn't always a bad thing. In some games, it's perfectly acceptable. I have played many games, especially Take That games, party games, games like Munchkin, any of those games that are Take That, where your entire goal is to screw over other players. It's perfectly acceptable to screw over another player for an outside the game reason or because it's funny. Munchkin, Hex, Lifeboats, Cashing Guns, Survive, Get Bit, even some lighter Euros like Downfall of Pompeii. I know our kids love throwing each other's little cylinder people into the volcano.
I was thinking, one of the times I was thinking about this at a public play event, and times I've seen this play out in either the positive or the negative event, are games like Monstrosity, where you don't necessarily vote for the person who has the best drawing because they're your partner, or you are voting for your partner despite the fact that their drawing doesn't actually look like anything like the things. You know, I have seen more often than not in those drawing games, because again, the voting, when you're voting, it can get awkward.
So how about when everyone always decides to pick on me from round one because they've decided mom always wins?
Well, that's
because you always win. I think that can be a problem, really. I think that can be an issue, though. What I would say is it's the start of the game and no one has the lead, I'm probably going to go into the person I think is going to win either way. That's where I think it is fair to target the player you know who is better at the game than you to give you that early advantage. But if there's an advantage to attack someone else, I think you're better off doing that. I'm saying attack. And Sean brought up another point that's important too, is I've also seen it go the other way, right? I've seen it flipped where people I don't know if it's to avoid the feeling of favoritism. They don't want it to feel like nepotism, so they personally attack their significant other or their friend or their sibling or the person at the table they know the most, where the one player will go out of their way to be overly mean to that one player to go, look, I'm being fair. Look, just because we're siblings doesn't mean we're going to work together. And I've seen that almost, not necessarily ruin a game, but kind of ruin the fun for everyone else.
Because that's not only, there's that, and some of it is definitely, I have definitely seen, you know, I'm not playing favorites. Look how I'm attacking that person who you think I would be friends. But it's also a matter of, I know that I can, again, it's that I can be angry with them and we can deal with it later. Whereas I don't know you. The avoiding of conflict is a big thing. Mm-hmm. We've already had someone in the chat room say, absolutely, safer to play cooperative games than to get into arguments. There are a lot of people in the gaming space who don't want that level of conflict, are against it, perhaps for personal reasons, for historical reasons, for whatever reasons. They aren't comfortable in the there is conflict in this game. It is part of the game. Right. And then when the game is over, that conflict is no longer.
See, in that case, to me, I just don't play those games, right? Like, so our comment in the chat is actually they prefer to play cooperative games so that they don't get into arguments. Mm-hmm. And that, I think, is the proper answer for that one, is if you know it's a game where you're playing Take That and you don't like stabbing strangers in the back, don't play Take That games with strangers. Save them for at home with your personal group that you're used to playing with, or your personal family. And I think that's just knowing your expectations when you sit down to play. And I think the group in the chat room in particular knows that that's how they're, what their group enjoys and what they don't. I think you do have to watch for that.
Yeah, I prefer not to play co-ops for the reverse reason, because co-ops will lead to arguments.
Whereas I've
seen that too.
I don't actually mind playing conflict with strangers as much, because I don't feel guilty attacking someone I don't know, because it isn't personal. I have no idea who this person is. Whereas sitting around with friends and family, I might feel more guilty and more hesitant to attack people for, especially when there isn't a game leader. That's one of the biggest problems, is when everyone is more or less equal and you've got that card where it's like, well, I have to attack someone. Who the heck do I attack? Everyone is at the same place. No one has that lead that I need to take away from them. Where do I go? And again, that's where that whole randomness comes in. I could just pick someone at random, but it's not going to be random. There's going to be something behind it.
And honestly, that's where I don't think it's a problem. Like, that's where, if there's no other mitigating factor, attack whoever you want for whatever reason you want, right? Mm-hmm. Whether it's, you know, something that happened in a game last week, whether it's you want some brownie points for later that night, whoever, you know, help pay for the pizza, whatever you want. In that case, when everyone's about even, I think that's where it doesn't actually matter and it's not a problem. And again, I still think certain games are designed for it, and it fits. Cashing guns, pointing the gun at your siblings or whatever. Well, that sounds terrible. But pointing the foam gun that's very clearly a toy at your parents. Kids love to attack the parents while playing games. It is part of the fun of the game.
They got into some really specific details in the question, like not sitting couples side by each that they wouldn't play one turn after the other. I would have never gotten to that level of thinking this out.
Yeah, I've never seen it become that much of a problem where I felt the need to split people up. But I will say, I have played games where we split up the couples. Like, if you're playing teams, I like to split the couples. Well, it totally depends on the game, but most games, if you're playing like a strategy game, right, something where a point leader, a point salad, a euro, in general, I'd rather split the family members. Now, party game, it goes both ways, right? Like, well, sometimes it's fun to play couple versus couple. Other times it's fun to mix up the group. So you play, you know, whatever, girls versus the boys or whatever else, however else you want to split it, adults versus the kids. Mm-hmm. So again, I think it's perfectly acceptable in the right game. And I think what a lot of this boils down to, And we've kind of thrown a couple in here, but I want to move on to tips for dealing with this if it is a problem. So step one, is it a problem? Figure it out. Like, if your group is perfectly cool with this and that's part of the group dynamic, there's nothing wrong with that. We're not telling you you can't attack your sibling or you can't play favorites with your wife, as long as everyone expects that at the table and everyone's okay with it. And this is something we've talked about many times on the show before, and that is the social contract of sitting down to play a board game. Now, I know when I say that, a bunch of people are like, ooh, contracts, what are you talking about? These are supposed to be games, supposed to be fun. But whether you realize it or not, when you sit down to play a game, you are taking part in a social contract. It's an unwritten one, and that contract depends on the nature of the game. And again, playing favorites is part of some games. Many party games are like that. But then other ones, you generally, when you sit down to play a strategy game, something where you're adding up points and there's going to be a definite winner, that contract tends to be, when it's your turn, you're going to play to try to win, even if winning isn't that important. Like, we're not talking about playing for money. If we want to talk about tournament play, that is completely different beast, where, yes, everyone should be playing to win, and everything they do should make it so that they get closer to winning the game with every action they take. But I think if you're sitting down, especially with strangers at a public play game night, like, say, our last one at the Walkerville Brewery, and you're about to sit down and play Sushi Boat, the assumption is you're going to play to win. And you're not going to do something like, I'm going to tip this waitress to move the sushi so you can get it, so that you do better. Thank you, honey. Right? You don't want that to happen in that kind of game, unless, again, you set that expectation ahead of time.
Okay, I take back everything I said previously. If someone did that in a tournament, I would be livid.
See? There you go.
Yeah, again, tournaments are definitely a different beast. I think for the most part, this question and this discussion is involving, friendly play, game nights out, regular family game nights. I think we can probably assume that this isn't, full on tournament play, although it could be a very right. competitive group. You never know.
And it totally depends. Again, this is the same thing we talk about all the dang time, right? It's get everyone on the same page. It's session zero. It's setting expectations. It's you sit down and sit down to play the game. And if you are a couple, you can even tell people, you're like, look, Deanna and I, we're together, but trust me, we're not going to play favorites here. If I'm attacking Deanna, it's because I think she's going to win the game. And if she's attacking me, she thinks I'm getting close to overtaking her score. And you can explain that. Or you can sit down and go, you know what? We like to play favorites. We hold grudges. We play this game as cutthroat as possible. And that's perfectly fine if everyone agrees to it.
I do hold grudges. I might be attacking you because you told everyone that I'm going to win the game.
There you go. Now, the things you're expected to do, right, we talked about this, is target the current leader or someone you expect to take the lead. Because some people are like, you got to target the leader. And I'm like, yeah, I could target the leader, but I know D has a handful of whatever over there. Or I know Sean's almost completed a full set that's going to give him the lead. And while it looks like Dave's winning, I know Sean's actually way closer than it looks like. So I'm going to attack Sean. One of the things you can do is talk about it. Now, this is totally, again, a group thing and who you're playing with. Whether they're open to table talk. And I know Deanna hates it when people point that out. But if someone does like kind of give you a weird look because you're attacking a sibling or a friend or looking like you're paying favorites, you can explain, well, I'm attacking them because, look, I'm going to go up by 3 points, where if I attack Sean, I'm only going to go up by 2. And overall, it's a 6-point spread.
I don't like when you start using Jedi mind tricks to try and encourage other people to make certain moves at the table. I know what you do. So that's a different complaint.
Yeah, I don't know. That's not really favoritism whatsoever. I just suggest moves to other players that are valid for them to take. That's all mm-hmm. it is.
Yes.
Sometimes valid, those moves unfortunately, help me too.
Valid does not mean good, but valid. One of the things I think is there's definitely a benefit to, especially at a public play event, and especially at an event like Walkerville, I think was a great example, where if we as experienced players are sitting down with some newer gamers or some, first time gamers or whatever, explaining some of our reasoning for doing things, if we are in a take that mm-hmm. situation, is actually a really great way to not only, lessen any tension, but also help them learn to play the game better. And help them be better gamers.
If it does become an actual problem. So what do you do if this happens, right? You're sitting at a table and you see it happen. Try to be adults, try to talk about it, right? If you failed to set the expectations ahead of time, just be like, excuse me, like, why are you helping them out? Because that move doesn't make any sense in the game we're currently playing. You'd have a better advantage helping everyone else. I'm just wondering why you would make that move. And maybe they'll point out something like, well, because next turn I'm going to play this card, which means I get to steal all those resources back to go back to Catan and the evil Monopoly card. So maybe that's what it is. Or maybe they don't realize they're doing it. Again, like Sean was saying about the randomness and the whole fear of affecting strangers, right? The conflict aversion. Maybe that's why they're doing it. But like the whole thing is, you're not sitting down, again, unless you're in a tournament where you're not allowed to talk to each other. There's no sacred bond here, right? You're just sitting here. You're all trying to play a game together and all have fun together. And maybe they don't realize that it's ruining the fun of other players and bring it up. Like, I know it's hard, right? As someone who also has some social anxiety issues, it's not always easy to do, but bring it up.
I think that would make me really uncomfortable. Particularly, like, I'm playing a strategic game, I'm probably thinking 2, 3, 4 turns ahead, and I probably did something because I'm planning something further along. And if you ask me, then I have to reveal to you that I have this card or I'm going to do this thing.
You could just say, I've got plans. This.
Yeah, I have plans is potential.
Is probably valid, yeah. And it's totally different if you're playing with new people. You're teaching people, that's different. But I mean, like, if you're playing a competitive game, I don't know. I think that would make me uncomfortable.
I can see issues where there's a couple who has, you know, game night all the time together, and they're you know, and all of a sudden they're out at a public event and they have between themselves unspoken agreements about how things go. Maybe they maybe they are brutal with each other, and seeing that behavior transitioned into a public play event or a new game group could certainly be uncomfortable for other people. And that's where everyone needs to sort of stop and say, look, what's going on here? Is this normal? Are we okay here? Right. That person's going to win now because you two are slashing and burning each other's fields. You know, there's definitely times where a couple who has their own dynamic introduced into a new environment could get things awkward.
And Kat and Tori used to like pretend like their table talk would be extra mean towards each other because they thought it was comic, right? Something they would frequently do when we were playing with them all the time. I don't think they really tipped the game, but they would trash talk each other a lot.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And the amount of trash talk at a table, again, that's a very group dependent thing. That's something if you like to trash talk and you go to a public play event, maybe hold back a bit to see what the feelings are at the rest of the table. Or just, again, come right out front and say it. Say, hey, at our tables, we like to trash talk. Everyone good with trash talk? There's no problem asking for consent at the tabletop game table. That is not a bad thing. It is a good thing. I wish more people were comfortable with. I've definitely sat down at a table where people are like, we like to trash talk. Is that cool? And I'm like, yeah, sure, go for it. Or, you know what? No, we don't really know each other. And it might be hard to differentiate what's serious and what's not. And if I actually hurt anyone's feelings for this game, at least, can we keep it on the down low? And maybe if we play a second round, we can get more into it.
But I remember with Kat and Tori, like, they would sound like they were being mean to each other sometimes, to the point that we took the kids aside that were sometimes listening to us play and say, okay, guys, they're joking. That's not a normal relationship. Okay. So I could see if you had people come out and do that in a public play and you didn't know them, you might be like, the heck are they doing over there? That's, you know.
Absolutely. And to be fair, again, because we're all different, we all have different things. And sometimes we just aren't the people who can confront someone else on an issue. Not all game nights work. Not all game nights go well. There are failures. And if you want to check out episode number 78, They Can't All Be Great, we discuss on what things to do when we have those game nights that just don't go the way you expect.
Definitely happens.
Yeah, part of that, we actually talk about potential player problems. We talk about RPGs as well as board games, what to do if the game is failing with everyone at the table and so on. So yeah, if you're looking for details on how to have these conversations, what to talk about, that is a great place to look. And then there's also an article on game night failures over on the blog, which I'll throw a link to in our show notes.
So other than that, in our chat room, we've had a few people talking. Again, we had Charlie Brown saying, 100% agree with you, safer to play cooperative games than to get into arguments. Whereas Trasharama says, I'm fine with conflict if the rules are well defined. Mm-hmm. Where conflict is defining the rules themselves, they don't like, which is games like Magic the Gathering. And then Roger Dodger says, I've seen some feelings get hurt in a game, but their group bounces back pretty fast. And that's a good thing to know about your game group, is whether or not they are able to recover quickly, or if there could be grudges and hard feelings if something isn't done or something isn't said.
Yeah, I got to say, the Magic the Gathering, I'm perfectly fine with until it goes out of the game stuff, like people cheating and yelling at other players and flipping tables and screaming, and when the game's done being bad sports, which is not really the playing favorites thing. Now, I don't know in some of the other Magic variants, when you're playing multiplayer, if there's a way to help out other players that would fit this topic a little better. But yeah, part of the overly competitive gamers can be a problem. But as I've suggested many times, when you're talking public play events, if you can sit them all at the same table and they'll have a ton of fun with each other.
Yeah. Charlie Brown mentions, I enjoy competitive play in public venues, even with Deanna, because you know she's playing to win. Cosmic Encounters solves this problem as you are told who to attack. That's actually, there's a few games like that out there, which are fantastic options for that problem, where, you know, you're only ever attacking to the left, or you're only ever attacking who the dice tell you to attack. More of those would actually be a good thing, I think.
One of the games we're reviewing tonight has that when you play with three or more players.
Mm-hmm.
I tried. I like the way that game does it because it's got a you roll to see who to attack, but two of the options are your opponents choose or you choose. So I like that a little better than Cosmic Encounter.
Well, and there's the group play. I want to say is it Emperor in the Star Realms, the new Star Realms format, where you can't attack the Emperor until.
Yeah, only the players on the sides. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Charlie Brown says they did lose a player due to trash talking and thought to define it until something bad happened. And unfortunately, that's often the case that it takes something negative to bring it all up and make people understand.
We know it's hard to do, but if you are uncomfortable during a game, if you can stop the game, say, can we please stop? Point out what you didn't like. Say, hey, we can keep playing, but please, you know, I don't appreciate the trash talk. Can we tone that down a bit? That's all you got to say. Mm-hmm. I know very few gamers who are going to take the attitude of, well, no, that's part of the fun. They're going to be like, oh, sorry. Like, it's not intentional in most cases.
Yep.
People aren't trying to make it not fun for other people.
Yeah. And a lot of times, again, it goes back to that what you know. If, you know, it's those people who do that all the time in their own home games and are suddenly in a different situation and they don't know to stop because they've never had to before. Or it's just come so naturally to them that they need to, you know, bite their tongue a little more often, and people need to remind them to do that sometimes.
All righty. Thank you, chat room, for all the additional comments.
All right. So that's our chat room. And before we wrap up our talk on playing favorites, let's slip in a message from our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild.
Have you ever wondered what it'd be like if the Addams family had a garden? Well, you can find out in La Familia Hort, where Granny Hortensia, the owner of the lands of an eccentric Hammers family, dies without leaving a will. During the next blood moon, Granny appears to her four grandchildren and presents an opportunity. Whoever has the most successful garden, after she appears three more times, will inherit all of her lands.
That's the premise in La Familia Hort, coming to retail from Grand Gamers Guild. Players take on the roles of Granny Hortensia's grandkids, who will purchase tiles from a central market to place in their fields, fertilize and water their crops, and then sell them for coins to purchase more crops or experience points. The grandkids with the most experience after three blood moons wins. Grandkid, singular.
La Familia Hort features awesome Edward Gorey-style artwork and asymmetric gameplay and a short playtime of well under an hour. It will be hitting retail later this year, or you can pick it up now directly from Grand Gamers Guild for only $29.99, and that's before you use our special code Bellhop, BELLHOP, to save 10% off.
That's it for our discussion on playing favorites at the board game table, how to avoid it, as well as realizing that it can be perfectly fine depending on the group. It's just all about setting expectations ahead of time. Have you experienced board game nepotism at your table? Share your horror stories in the comments.
Or better yet, jump on the Tabletop Bellhop Discord at discord.tabletopbellhop.com and share your stories there.
Now it's time for the Bellhop's Tabletop, where we talk about the games that we've been playing lately.
So we've got lots to talk about today because this past week we were part of two local gaming events. One being the first ever Brews and Board Games event at the Walkerville Brewery that I honestly think couldn't have gone better. It was a fantastic event and surpassed all our expectations, I think.
Yeah, it was awesome. I think we had over 100 people out. Everyone seemed like they're having a great time. There was, it was like 24 tables of games going on simultaneously. People playing lots and lots and lots of games. And we were worried going in that it could be everything from we would have too many people and we wouldn't know what the heck to do because we wouldn't have brought enough games, to everyone would show up and only want to play Monopoly. And that would be a problem because we did not have that. So none of our worries panned out. And we were also worried no one would show up and it would be us and a pile of games and a beer. I'd still get to drink a beer, so it wouldn't be that bad. But it was fantastic.
Yeah, most of my night was greeting people, finding games for people to play, teaching games. I did sit down and play a couple myself, but that was all to get groups going. So I play like, you know, one round, one part of a game, or the first couple rounds or something like that, so that people could play on their own. One of the big ones was Psychobabble. I just sat down and did the therapist role once to teach a younger group who all showed up with magic cards. So I don't know if they were all just there to play magic, or they wanted to play magic, or they're there to experience it. I didn't get the full story out of them. But a younger group to sit down and play Psychobabble. This game hasn't failed yet. It went absolutely fantastic. This group was absolutely enamored with the game. After the second round, they went around, which they did without any help. I just kept stopping in to check on them. They had like five more friends show up, and they had like a huge, like 8-person game going by the end. And I don't think they grabbed another game. They just kept playing round after round after round of Psychobabble. So yet again, Outset Media guy, thank you for forcing us to take mm-hmm. that one home. It is proving to be very popular.
Yeah, before we go any further into the games we played, I know that you wanted to talk about the menus that we made, because that went over really well.
What did I want to say about the menus? All I will say is creating a board game menu was very much worth it. Before we went to the event, we did make a menu. It didn't have every game that was on the list, but we broke it out into like simple, quick, under 15-minute games, classics that had like Carcassonne, Catan, Ticket to Ride on it. Then we had like main courses, which were most of the strategy games we had there. On the back, we had Finger Foods, which was a list of dexterity games. And then we had, I forget what we called them, the big expensive games. They're not expensive, long games, heavy games. I can't remember. What did you say?
Epic Meals.
Yeah, Epic Meals, something I think we put. That had like Marrakesh on that. So we had a range of games. They proved extremely popular. They worked very well. I'm very glad I took the time to put those together. That actually goes back from one of our podcast episodes forever ago, where we were talking about how to pick what games to play. And while I was doing research for that, I had found a website called Board Game Menu, but it would use your Board Game Geek collection to create you a menu. And I just love that idea. And I'm like, no, I want to do that, not just pulling randomly from my Board Game Geek collection, but a curated list. Some people kept them. I had someone in the chat noting they kept a copy as souvenirs. I had one other person say, this is fantastic. You just gave me a shopping list, and they plan on, you know, checking off every game on the list that sounded good to them. It's going to become a regular thing for those nights. And yes, we will be changing up the menu for each event. Every month, you will not see the same game. Some will probably stay the same. Those classics will probably always be on there, though I'm not going to bother bringing up my big, giant, deluxe, expensive Ticket to Ride again since no one played it. But the other games on that list will probably stay the same.
Yeah, they seem to go over really well. And I have to say, I liked being able to say, oh, you look lost. We made a menu. Take a look at this. I'm like, that was a good icebreaker. Sean might have felt the same way, because I know he did a lot of the greeting. For me, it was a nice icebreaker.
Yeah, but, absolutely. The big thing was watching those people who had walked in either not knowing there was an event, or knowing there was an event but not really having any grasp of what it was that the event was. And they mm-hmm. walked over to the table, and they were just like completely deer in headlights. And that was where the menu came out, and immediately it was either the two player or the dexterity games, or those really the easier stuff that were going to get people who didn't know what the heck was going on playing quickly. And it was just fantastic. Whereas people who understood the hobby games could take a little more time and peruse the entire menu.
Mm-hmm. Now, I will say they did fail on one point. Where they set an expectation there would be table service. Mm-hmm. So that was the only disadvantage I saw with the menus, is some people would sit down at the table, see the menu, and expect someone to come over and serve them like a menu. And what can I get you, and bring a game over and teach it to them. Sorry, that's not, we do not have enough staff to pull that off.
Maybe that we need to add a note.
Yeah, maybe the games are located, except that we didn't know where the games were going to be located. Self-serve something. I don't know.
Maybe it'll be something we can put on there in small text. The game buffet.
Yes, serve yourself at the buffet. I'm not sure. Maybe there's something small. Though, honestly, I only saw one couple get confused by that. So I don't think it was an overall problem. I think most people kind of got the gist. Now, Roger is asking if we could add other people's games. I don't think so. Again, the menu is just a subset of what we're bringing. It's not even everything we brought. There will be other games present, and I think the expectation, because I don't want anyone to have bad feeling. Why'd you add Roger's game, but you didn't put my game on there? And it requires a level of coordination before the event that, honestly, I don't want to get involved in.
Mm-hmm. Those menus were a lot of work.
Yeah, one thing we did talk about at the end of the night, and we'll probably take part next time, is a better arrangement of the buffet table. So that things are a little more laid out. And that's where other people's games, if they are interested in taking part, no one has to, obviously, but if you are bringing games and are interested in letting other people play those, how those are arranged on the table can definitely be a part of it.
Maybe we even set up two tables, like we have that table and a side table. So everything on the menu is on the one table, and maybe put a sign there to say menu items or something. And then the other table could say a la carte and a sign that says, you know, feel free to play these games too.
That's a good idea. Anyway, all right. So I started off tonight teaching a game of Terraforming Mars Ares Expedition. Did I get the name right?
Yep.
Yeah. So that's the new, more concise, you know, consolidated version of Terraform Mars. I'm not going to describe the game. I'm terrible at describing games. I will describe that that's the second time I've played it. And I'm digging it. I did not mind teaching it. And it was really easy to teach to people that had played Terraforming Mars before. And they know that. They even put a crib sheet in the rule book saying, hey, here's your quick start if you've played Terraforming Mars. This is how it's the same. This is how it's different. I had one person at the table that had never played Terraforming Mars before. And he still was able to catch on pretty quick. It's a good game. It's a lot of it is, it has the same, a lot of the same mechanics as Terraforming Mars. But yeah, I can't think of what else I want to say about it. I didn't hate teaching it, and I played it. It was good. I remember what it was. There is the one thing, this is really multiplayer solitaire, and it even suggests that you play it simultaneously. And what I've noticed now, again, I've only played it twice, but there's no take that elements, and there's no interacting with other people's cards, and I'm not seeing cards. Now, they may be in there. I haven't played every card, obviously, but I'm not seeing cards that are based on how many of X tags someone else at the table has. I'm only seeing stuff that minds my own business. I think if you were playing it simultaneously, it could end up being a very quick game. We had people at the table that wanted to play it, you know, going around and not playing simultaneously, mainly because we did have someone that had never played Terraform Mars before and they just weren't comfortable with that. But so I thought that was an interesting difference. There's a lack of interaction and a lack of the take that element.
Another one I actually played at the event. No, we're not going to talk about every game we teach because we'd be here all night. Catch the Moon. Catch the Moon proved to be very popular. That was the game I grabbed if people were totally lost and didn't know what they wanted to play. If they looked at the menu and were just overwhelmed, I'm like, hey, how about we start off with something simple? Everyone loved the theme. And I always taught it without explaining everything until a ladder fell. Then I went, oh, you made the moon cry, and handed them a tear. That actually went off with good effect. It ended up being a big hit. It catches people's attention. It was one of those where that and Go Cuckoo, where once the game was set up and people were playing, people at other tables were like, can I play that next? What are they playing over there? They were the two games that I think caught other people's attention. And that game just got passed around. Like, I don't think Catch the Moon sat on the buffet table for very long that night.
Yep.
Sean ended up grabbing me and telling me that I had to play Zensu with Charles, because up till now I was undefeated at Zensu. But given that I have played Mo, Sean, and my one daughter, and that's it, right? So I sat down, I taught the game to Charles. I did win the first game versus Charles. I did not win the second game versus Charles. But Charles was taking that game seriously. He was intent. Like, he was, like, just so, like, laser focused, not talking. He didn't look like he was breathing. He was just playing that game. And I'm like, okay, I'm not taking this seriously enough, apparently. I gotta up my Zensu game a bit, so...
To be fair, I mean, Charles was the one person we knew who could possibly, even if D, was a grandmaster at the game, the one person in Windsor who we knew would be able to face off against D was Charles, who is, you know, a highly skilled player of games like chess and other such games, and takes those games very seriously. I actually had a really great time interacting with people. I sort of fell at home at the buffet table, interacting with people, introducing them to different games, and just helping them pick up something, especially those folks who walked over with that deer in headlights look. Oh, we're here. We have beer. We want to do something. But I have never seen any games that look like this ever. Mm-hmm. I even got myself in a couple of quick teaches, one of Drop It and Point Salad. I am not a good teacher. I do not claim to be a teacher. I'm quite happy to help people pick things out. And then I'm going to wave down either Dee or Mo or Gwen to come over and help these people learn the game now that I've got it set up for them. I generally, you know, for those of you who know me, I'm not a real people person. I do have all sorts of social anxieties, but manning that game table was a role that I enjoy and fell into quickly. I did sneak in a game of Go Cuckoo up front, and then Mo got me into my first play of Sushi Boat as well before things got too busy.
So what did you think of Sushi Boat? Because I know we're all kind of on the fence on that one so far.
I'm pretty on the fence about it.
Yeah,
it's fine. It's an all right game. It really didn't engage me deeply. but yeah. it was fine. I mean, again, you know, I sitting around having a drink, chatting with people and pushing some sushi around a boat.
Yeah, I ended up playing Go Cuckoo as well. I'd actually forgotten that one. That one I forgot to put in my board game app, whatever it's called, that I never remember the name of, that I finally bought. So I didn't love that one, but I did play that. The one that amused me about that, though, is I don't know, 6 years ago, I don't even remember how long ago we were doing easy mode events, but it was one of our early easy mode events. And this group of younger gamers showed up. I think they were in university, might have even been high school. Looked like kids to me, right? Showed up and with a copy of Scrabble. And that's what they showed up to this, you know, board game night. And I offered to teach them some games and they're like, nah, I don't know. And they played Scrabble. And then I went over at the end of their game of Scrabble. And I said, OK, I get it. If you're worried to learn something complicated, but this is not complicated. And I slammed Go Cuckoo down in front of them. And I played a 4-player game with them and it blew their minds. It was one of those like they were just like, what? This can be a game. This is what gaming can be. This isn't work. I don't have to do math. I don't, you know. So it blew them away. And now here's the awesome part. So the three of them were there Thursday, now 6 years older. Of the three, two of them are now married to each other. So it just shows that this group of friends has stuck around and they played 5, 10, I don't even know. But they spent most of the night playing Go Cuckoo together and kind of drawing in people around them so that they were playing from 3 to 6 players throughout most of the night. So it's just awesome to see a group that like I introduced to Go Cuckoo years ago coming out to our most recent playing public play event.
Yeah, I think my favorite moment of the night was this lovely couple, French Canadian couple came over. And I don't think they knew there was going to be an event. I think they may even have been tourists who just like went to find Walkerville Brewery. Right. And were just, you know, oh, this is really interesting. What's going on here? Blah, blah. And it turned out that they had no idea about games, but they were both foodies. And I picked up a copy of Point Salad and said, all right, let's walk over. Where are you guys sitting? Where do you want to sit? And went over to the bar and set them up a 2-player game of Point Salad at the bar, and they played at least one game, probably 2 or 3 games before they were done, and said thank you and made their way out after bringing the game back. That was watching these two people who were just like absolutely no gamers, no intent to game, nothing at all, just get into it and enjoy you know, a few nice glasses of wine and some Point Salad.
Overall, the event was awesome. Like it went extremely well. Ton of new faces. Like, yes, we got some of our regulars out that we see at all our events, people I've been gaming with since 2002, but we also got out a ton of people I've never seen out playing games before. And like Deanna said, it was every table. It was like 24 tables of gamers playing games. It felt like walking into the open play area of Origins, except we're not at a game con, we're at a bar in Walkerville. Right. It was just awesome. And it blew away not only us, but the venue. Walkerville was extremely happy with the turnout and has already booked us for 2 more events. So you're hearing it here first. We will be back for 2 more rounds of brews and board games at the Walkerville Brewery. These are on Thursdays running 5 to 9. The next one will be Thursday, April 25th. The one after that will be Thursday, May 23rd. So book your Fridays off work now so you can come out and enjoy some fantastic beer and some board games.
I am super looking forward to it. I am so excited to see so many local people out and playing games.
Yeah. And especially a variety of people, not and as much as we adore all of our regular fans and the folks who show up to all the different events we know, seeing those people plus an entirely new crop of people taking on and enjoying board games was really fantastic.
Next up, more public play, a very successful barbershop bar game night. I don't know if it was just the long weekend, so everyone was out, but it did extremely well for that venue as well. I actually ran out of tables for the first time at one of those events. Thankfully, when one couple was turned away due to an order to sit, we did manage to find a table in the back and get them set up. It was a really good night for the barbershop bar, despite them having some lighting issues, which I have been promised have been fixed. They have a new app and you won't have to deal with black light in half the room.
Yeah, early on, Dee and I sat down with Distilled for a play and a teach with both two new players and Roger Dodger in the chat room, who does know the game very well. We took the opportunity to add in 3 out of 4 parts of the new Cask Strength Expansion. We did decide that the variable price market might be a little bit much to add in for the new players, but the rest of it seemed straightforward enough.
Like it's a wee little module. It's just like a wee little deck of cards. And I was surprised that there was 4 modules in there in the expansion. And it does say straight up that you should not be playing it if you haven't played before. So I thought, well, with 2 new players at the table, I'm going to look through and go, this part seems easy. This part seems easy. Okay, let's leave out that one. And so we put in 3 out of 4 modules. And so there was new distillery upgrade cards there. And one of those had a very specific power, which I'll get back to in a second, which was where the cast strength came from. And there was new flavor cards. And the new flavor cards were... they were just give you 1 coin, it's a flavor, but at the bottom it had a thing that said you could now discard one of your other flavor cards. If you ended up getting like the skunk one and you didn't want it, you toss that and you'll draw 1 blind off the top of the deck and replace a flavor card. So there was, I think, 4 flavor cards that were added to the deck mixed in that would give you that ability. And then there was the variable market, which we did not use, which is a deck of cards that you flip up and, I mean, I guess we'll get into that when we actually try it. And then there was new premium ingredients, which you actually take out. So in the game, there's 32 ingredients, and then there's 2 waters, mountain spring water or whatever, and 2 turbo yeast. So you keep the turbo yeast, you keep the deluxe water, you take out the other 32 ingredients, and you completely replace them with these new premium ingredients. It's all the same items, but they now have little powers at the bottom, and it just adds more ways to combo cards. You can now get points or money for more things by having, like, you'll have a fruit card that'll say for every other fruit that's in your successful brew, then you will get an extra point, or you will get an extra dollar. Or if this card is in your brew, you will get... and that's the wrong word. It's in your, what is it called mash. When it's
your mash?
Thank you. Yeah. If this card's in your mash, then you will get a basic grain card into your pantry and stuff like that. So I thought it was neat. I really liked the premium ingredients, like in a put them in and don't ever take them out kind of way. Of the new, there was 4 new distillery upgrades. One of them was a specialist that was the moonshine expert, something like that. The name was Moonshiner or something like that. I think Sean got that one.
Yeah.
Which
you could always make moonshine at any time. And then you got extra at the end of the game. You got extra points if you had tons of moonshine.
The one that I ended up buying was the cask sales upgrade. And what it allowed you to do was sell things without cellaring them. You didn't have to age them. You would take it, the round you distilled it, and you would put it in the cask with no bottle, and you would sell it in the cask. You would discard the cask, even if it's one that would normally go back to your pantry, and you would get 1 flavor card because it's assumed that it would age and gain flavor after you sold it to someone. So it allowed you to sell things very quickly. And I wasn't sure about it at first. Like as we were playing, I thought this isn't good because everyone else is aging stuff and their stuff is going to age and be worth a bazillion points at the end. And I'm consistently getting points every round because I managed to get this card off and then do a bunch of stuff that normally would have had to age. But it played out. I won. I was playing against two people who had never played before, though, so I don't think that is a good indication of how strong the card is. It's interesting mechanic. Mo said he thought it might be unbalancing because only one person at the table gets that ability. But, I mean, it has to come up in the deck. You have to buy it. And it definitely has its downsides because I wasn't collecting bottles if I was selling everything in the cask like that, right? So I think it's balanced. I don't know. Yeah. What'd you think of it, Sean?
You definitely took a hit at the end game scoring. Mm-hmm. The bottles in particular really hurt you. And if that hadn't come up as early as it did in the game, if it had been even one round later, mm-hmm. there probably would have been a distinct decision to make whether or not you wanted to even grab that at that point. Mm-hmm. So if it doesn't come up early enough, I think there's definitely a much bigger risk in taking that over going with the actual cellaring route. So yes, I think it has the opportunity to imbalance things depending, but as long as everyone knows it's there, sees it come up and it comes up in the early rounds, then you've got the opportunity to work against it, especially none of us really had good bottle collections. And that was something mm-hmm. I had made a mistake on. I was spending elsewhere and Dee and I were actually competing on ingredients that ended up sucking down my cash more than I would have if I had been going for bottles the way I probably should have been.
So it sounds like one of the things it does, though, is loosen up the game a bit, because as it is, Distilled's extremely tight and unforgiving, where it sounds like there is definitely, especially those powers on the ingredients, as well as those new flavors, just something to just loosen it up just a little bit so it's not quite as punishing.
I don't know. Roger missed out on one distilling phase. He didn't have the ingredients by mistake.
Yeah.
And that's wrong.
That can happen, though. I think Roger forgot a rule where you can always trade your basic ingredients for other ingredients.
Yeah. And I should have caught it when we were playing.
He was missing
water, but you can always trade another ingredient for water.
Yeah, but then I think he would have been short of something else. I don't think he had enough to do it. I'd have to.
Oh, okay, because in general, it's almost impossible to not brew something. Because of the rule where you're allowed to trade in your ingredients for lower cost ingredients.
He had no spare ingredients. That's what I thought.
Okay. No spare. Okay.
Because Roger's played the game before. It's not his first time.
Oh, Roger pointed out we've been playing Extreme, yes. So I'm pretty there sure was a rule he knows the rules.
And that actually makes a big change as far as I'm concerned. That discovery or that realization seems to be a huge deal for as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, see, I still don't think it's going to impact things much. I don't think it would have changed it much, but we'll see. We will play it for anyone who isn't aware. And I don't know if we have to offer an apology for getting it wrong in our review, but you do not have to have your signature ingredient in the mash to brew your signature alcohol. You can have the same premium ingredient. You don't have to. I can't remember an example. You don't have to have whatever plums. You just have to have plums.
Right. Juniper berries. You can have the premium ingredient juniper berries. You don't need the common juniper berries or the
whatever dried juniper berries. My special ingredients were dried juniper berries. But if you just had the normal juniper berries, that's fine too. Or sugarcane versus sugarcane juice was another one that somebody else had.
Yes. Which, again, I don't know. I don't know how much of an impact. I have not played with it.
It comes up faster. Distilled. That was the big thing.
Yeah, you might be able to. So one of the things I like about the Barbershop Bar is it tends to be hobby gamers who know the event, who know each other, and I don't have to spend as much time hosting. It's usually regulars and gamers who bring their own games, and there's usually lots of people there trying to convince other people to play their games. So it's usually pretty easy for me to actually sit down and play some games. And I actually got in a number of games with longtime Bellhop fan Tech 2674 and his two daughters. The first was Quacks of Quedlinburg. Just did the base game. Probably should have kept Herb Witches in, though that wouldn't have been mean because this was a case of someone who owned the game asking me to teach it to them so they can go home and play their copy. And they didn't own Herb Witches, but maybe I could have got them to buy Herb Witches because Herb Witches is awesome. Honestly, what I was surprised was how easy it was to just not include that. It was pretty easy to sort out. The one thing I did keep in were the six pumpkins, which Tech did manage to buy a six pumpkin and follow the rule that every time he drew one, he did yell out six pumpkins. So good job there, Tech. It's a solid game. I still like Quacks. It's as enjoyable as it always was. And honestly, I didn't care that we didn't have Herb Witches. I like the game random. Next, Gwen and I grabbed Gwen and she came over to the table and we played Xylotar, which was a big hit. We played five players. I explained the ridiculous background and everyone laughed at the ridiculous background, but everyone also enjoyed the game and it took a round. There's just a tiny bit of a learning curve on that. After one hand, you've got it. But we did have to go through that. I'm not going to say anything more about Xylotar right now because we are going to be reviewing this one later. Next, I broke out Stool Pigeon. This is my first time playing this since bringing it home from Gamma Expo. And it's interesting. It's a tableau builder. I would call it a traditional card game. It does have some special suits and stuff like that. But it's a traditional style card game where you start with a tableau of four cards in front of you. You get to look at the bottom two cards. And your goal is to have the smallest tableau, the smallest total cards. You're going to draw a card off the top of the deck and you're going to swap it for one of your cards in play. And then there's a bunch of other little things going on. So you're a mafia and you're trying to clean up your crime scene and there's pigeon mafia and every pigeon card does a special ability, like letting you peek at your cards or swap with other players. But the big thing that's unique in this game is being able to off witnesses. So anytime someone plays a witness card, which is a numbered card, into the discard pile, someone else, if they know there's a witness of the same number in play, can grab that card and slap it on top of the pile, eliminating that witness. So you can actually get your own personal tableau down to as low as zero cards if you're able to eliminate all your witnesses. But there's that timing element, right? There's the dexterity element where you are slapping the card down. We played three rounds, I played three rounds, then left to teach a different group, Quacks of Quedlinburg, and the group of four just kept playing. So I don't know, text in the chat room, maybe you could tell us how many rounds they actually played of Stool Pigeon. Now, I will admit there was one rule I did forget to introduce in there, and that is the ability to off another player's witness. So if you know another player has a 10 when a 10 comes up, you can grab their 10 and slap it on the deck. And then you give them one of your witnesses to fill in the spot and you end up with one less witness. We did not use that. I finished off the night playing Kiss the Goblin. The reason Sean and Dee aren't talking is the Distilled game took the entire night. So they were still playing that. So while they finished up, they were doing the final scoring and stuff. We grabbed Kiss the Goblin, played with two players who didn't really know the D&D alignment system. But you know what? After going around the table once with the five of us, everyone seemed to get it. Lots of laughs. This one's still a big hit. And again, we're going to be reviewing this later, so I'm not going to get into the details now.
And next up, it was the long holiday weekend. And so while I was off doing my own thing, you guys got your own family Easter gaming in, I guess.
Yes. So we played. It was just our usual Sunday gaming night. We did bring my mom over and we had Easter dinner. Then I brought my mom home and we went back and we played games till almost midnight. So quite a bit of gaming going on. The first one was Dice Throne, Marvel Dice Throne. The set was Scarlet Witch, Thor, Loki, and Miles Morales. This was our first time playing four players, so we wanted to try it out four player before, again, reviewing it later tonight. It's interesting. When you play four players, you can play King of the Hill, but we tried out the team-based. We did Witch and Spidey versus Thor and Loki. What surprised me is how quick it was. I found it actually quicker than the two-player game, because you only have 50 health on each team and you share it. So each team has a shared pool of health. Again, we're reviewing this in a bit, so I don't want to say too much more. Deanna played that as well. Do you have any thoughts on Dice Throne?
I think I prefer the non-team version. I really liked when we played it two-player because it was just so quick. With four people at the table, it was just that little bit too long to get back around to my turn where it wasn't keeping my attention.
Next was more Xylotar. This was the first play for Brenda and Genevieve. They also enjoyed it. I was especially glad that Genevieve picked it up pretty quickly, though she had a little rough bit with the bidding system because I don't think she's ever played a trick-taking game with bidding before. So that made it a little bit interesting. Again, even though we're reviewing this tonight, I'll share now, I have a feeling this one's going to keep hitting the table in the coming weeks and months. Next, we sat down and played Stool Pigeon again. Did not go as well as it did at the barbershop bar. Basically degraded when the slapping real-time element became a bigger part of the game. It became even worse when I double checked the rules and noticed the whole fact you could off other players. Just the slapping didn't go as well. People were. I don't even know, like breaking rules about playing cards and playing the card they drew. And it was a bit of a mess. At this point, Deanna didn't like it very much.
Okay, it went from we sat down, we played the first round. I went, wow, this game's way better than I expected. I'm actually enjoying this. This is great. And then you're like, you can't use two hands. I'm like, what do you mean you can't use two hands? When you pick up the card, you have to pick up the card with one hand and then replace your card on the table and then take your card off the table and put it out. And I'm like, that's awkward. I'm going to keep screwing that up. I'm watching everyone else at the table screw it up. This is making me cranky. I don't like it. And then you're like, oh, actually, you have to slap it down. And I'm like, can't I just put it in front of me? And you're like, no, because if you have to slap it so that someone else's hand can come down over top of you and you know who hit it first. And I'm like, yeah, no, I'm not standing up and slapping the table. We needed a much smaller table. We did have the centerpiece in my mom's table, and it was from playing Xylotar, and it was probably too large, and a smaller table would be better, but I was like, I don't know. And then you got into double checking the rules and finding out that you can actually take other people's witnesses, which would mean that I need to reach way across the table and slap my mom's card to be able to say, hey, that's the one I'm doing. And I'm like, no, I'm gone. I'm lazy. I want to sit in my chair and play a game. I liked the strategicness of it, that I could see two of my cards and not the other two, and guessing, you know, what was better to swap and keeping track of all that stuff. And I didn't mind the powers for the pigeons. And like I said, the first round, I was like, hey, this is actually really fun. And then I went, no, this is not a game for me.
Yeah, it is very much a card game for people who like spoons, hex, those games, taco cat, goat cheese pizza, right? You have to be into that kind of game because it's got these memory elements, and it's got, and honestly, it feels a bit to me like Racco, with the drawing a card and replacing one of your cards, but then there's that real-time slapping element that is going to turn people off. Now, I did share a lot more thoughts on this one over on the Tabletop Bellhop Patreon, so if you go to patreon.com/tabletopbellhop, all access levels, anyone who's a patron does get access to it, and I share a little more information on how the game's played and ways I think I would fix it for next time. So if so inclined, please check that out.
I just want to acknowledge that I get that that's a genre and that other people would enjoy this game,
yeah,
just not me.
Finished off the night with a 4-player game of Monstrosity, first time breaking out the Cute Creatures expansion. As we pretty much learned in the unboxing, check out our Monstrosity unboxing, insert link here. But with cuter creatures, it's Monstrosity. There's no special rules, there's no changes, you just have 50 new monsters. That are meant to be cute. I would say cute is subjective. There were some I wouldn't call cute myself, but nothing horrific, right? Like a lot less pustules and ooze and claws and sharp teeth and insects that you got in the original game. The complaint I had was that the monsters were all just kind of there. They were just like, meh, I'm a monster. I'm standing upright. I'm looking a bit to the left. Like they were very static, and they were just kind of in the center of each card. I missed the dynamic poses of robots, which is my own fault for starting with expansion 2 before expansion 1, I guess. It's a good expansion, especially if your kids find the original creepy. It is 50 new monsters, but like, there's nothing must have here. Now, Easter Monday, we had another game night. This was just Genevieve stayed over at her mother or at her grandmother's, and we had three of us. So we tried out Artemis Project with the Satellites and Commanders expansion. I had originally thought, we play this once. That's all we need, right? Like, it's an expansion. It throws in a couple new things. That'll be enough. We'll know how it works, and we'll review it tonight. Well, no, this definitely felt like there was more to discover after only one play.
Yeah, no, this definitely needs more plays to figure out everything that's going on, but I love it. I'm so on the Commanders, but I adore the new Satellites.
And I want Sean to try this one before we review it, because it made way more of an impact to the game than I thought. So you do get two parts. There's Satellites. You're putting four new, they're called cradles, into the corner of the boards. Now, the game comes with like 8 possibilities in each corner. That's really impressive. And then there's Satellites that you can place your dice in. We happen to have the nice upgraded chunky ones. I don't know if there is a non-upgraded version. I know Mark's been playing around with the SKUs for Artemis Project, where he eliminated the retail version. Now you can only get the Pioneer. I think the expansion, the only one you can get, comes with the chunky Satellites. But it doesn't matter. It's just a board game upgrade. It looks cool. Once you put a die in a Satellite, you pick which corner it goes to. each corner gives a bonus when resolving like the next section of the board. So like the bottom right corner would affect the mines and the vents. The power of these is based on the die value there. So if you put like a 5 or a 6 in there, you're going to get a really good ability, but you bump by playing a lower number. So if you put a 5 or 6, it's really easy for another player to bump you. Now, the neat part is the satellites at the end of the round orbit the board, right? They spin around the moon, right? It's actually a nice thematic time in. At that point, you have to decide, do you maintain your satellite? And if you pay 2 minerals, your die not only stays in the satellite, it rolls up 1. So it moves to the next section of the board. It's now more powerful. That's pretty much it for satellites.
I like the decision points here. Like, do I pay to keep the satellite? And I'm going to roll my die up, knowing that I might be wasting, it's 2 minerals, I think. And yep. I'm wasting those resources if I end up getting booted out by someone with a lower die next round. And you're rolling it up higher, right? And then, or do I pay just to stay there for the chance, or do I leave? Because I don't, maybe I want to leave because I don't like where the satellite's moving to next round. And then I realized when we were getting further into it, I might leave because I want it empty so I can try and reclaim it and then just place it somewhere else. Like, yep. There's a lot of neat stuff going on there. And yeah, I dig it.
Now, the actual abilities in the cradles were neat. They opened up a whole new branch of decisions, right? If you one of the ones we had was if you're first on an expedition, you get an extra medal or points if your die is high enough. If you buy 2 buildings, get back the materials equal to your die value. Collect leftover resources from the mines and vents and things like that.
Yeah, I love the variability. Like, there was tons of options. I don't remember exactly how many were in the box, but it was definitely more than the 4 we put out, and they were all double-sided.
Yep. Yeah, there were 2 sets. But I think 4 for each corner. 4 different ones. Next is the commander part. The big thing you're getting here is a new type of... I worded this in the notes as a new type of colonist, but it's not. It's a new upgrade for your colonist, because the commander doesn't necessarily count as a colonist for a bunch of things. What it does is you replace the academy spot on the board with a new one. So you can still spend a die to upgrade one of your people, and then what they upgrade to is based on the die that stays. But now there's a new spot where you can send a die there with a colonist. Now, each of your colonist types has a value. You add that value to the value of the die. When you resolve that section, whoever has the highest total, so that's the addition of their die with their colonist, gets to upgrade that colonist to a commander, but they have to pay one of the medals, one of the rewards for completing expeditions, which I actually really like, because now there's a new way to spend your medals if you don't need them. Now, commanders are count as wild when you are placing them in buildings and for activating buildings, and they're wild for endgame scoring, including when you're completing sets. They also get their own free swap every upkeep fees. And they can be placed with a die anywhere on the board, making it count as 2 higher. But the thing is, they only counts as 2 higher. You don't actually bump the die. So like, if you have a 3 in the vents, you put a commander on it, like when you play it, and you're going to get 5 resources, but you still keep that 3 position, which honestly I found was the biggest thing that the commanders seemed to add to the game.
Yeah, I don't know. I haven't decided if I like the new commanders or not. They felt really expensive. Like, it's a big action to try to be at the top of the totem just to get the opportunity to upgrade to a commander. And you're giving up another colonist and one of those medals. And I mean, they feel like they're probably useful if you manage to get one near the beginning of the game, which you did. And you played it every round, so it was worth it for you, right? But they get less worth it as things progress. But then again, at the end, there are these new endgame point buildings that relied on having a commander. So then I ended up trying to grab some at the end. And I don't know. I need to play it again. Satellites, I'm sold on. Commanders.
Yeah, that's interesting to me, because the medals in particular are something that I have always strived to really work for, that high medal bonus, the 5 or 7 or whatever it is, to get the most points for medals. And so having to give up a medal when it's already an effort, like it's a tight game if you want to get enough medals in there. That's interesting. That's, I don't know.
But remember, in our game, we had a satellite to give us extra medals if you were in first, right? So that offset that.
Right.
That's what I was going to say. There was a way to get more.
Okay. At least in this game. Who knows? The other 3 possibilities for that corner may not. I don't know.
That's interesting.
Which would change how easy it is to get commanders. So I got to say, it's when you're in that sweet spot, though, of 3 to 5, where you're getting whatever it is, 3 points or whatever it is, you're not losing points. Why not spend a medal? right? It almost encourages you to. You're like, well, I have five. I'm not going to get to eight, which is the next threshold. I may as well spend a couple. Right. Now, the expansion also added new buildings, new events, new expeditions. All of them were great. Actually, all the ones that came up, we enjoyed. Like, they were just neat. They let you do neat new things, especially the rewards for the expeditions were very cool. And the buildings let you do interesting things. And the events that came up, I found them more enjoyable than the ones in the original game. They just seemed better tweaked. Overall, I thought it was great. It's one I can't see taking out now that it's in. But honestly, it's going to take a bit before we get a full review, because I want Sean to try it for one. But I want to try for with it at least two more sets, probably, of different satellites to make the final decision.
Yeah, the big one for me was that the more events, more expeditions, more variety, particularly with the events, which, if I remember correctly, in the base game, we would play through all of them, I think.
No, it was the expeditions.
It was the expeditions. We'd end up going through all of them. So I liked having more random stuff come up in there. It felt good. It was enjoyable. So I've got to talk about one final play. I sat down and taught Zensu to our youngest kid, Jen, and I haven't even told Mo about this yet. So I've decided it's my favorite game right now. I really like Zensu. So I thought, okay, I'm going to sit down and I'm going to teach Jen to play Zensu. And I even gave her a little spiel beforehand that I'm not going to go easy on you and you're going to lose. So don't get upset. Okay. And then,
she beat you.
Sucker beat me. So I was, I will say I wasn't taking her seriously because I thought, oh, you know, I'm going to make sure she gets all the experiences of the game. So I'm going to make this move just so she sees what happens with this move. And, you know, sure, I wasn't expecting her to. Yeah, no, I'm not. Excuses. She beat me. She beat me fair and square.
So now we got to get Jen versus snuck Charles.
In. She got a one all the way down to the end of the board. And I was like, you sucker. I see it. I can see that you're going to win in four rounds and I cannot figure out how to stop you. And I didn't say it to her. I'm just like, I kept going with it. But yeah, she beat me. And then we played a second time and I beat her. But the interesting thing with playing with Jen is she played different than anyone else I've played. And again, I haven't played from a lot of people, but it's just she kept doing moves that I completely did not expect. Like she did a lot of left and right lateral things instead of moving up or down. She would jump in to block in different ways that I hadn't even thought of. I was just, I really enjoyed playing her and seeing a different side of the game that I hadn't arrived at on my own.
Marvel Dice Throne lets you battle classic and well-known Marvel heroes through a Yahtzee-like dice system mixed with card-driven randomness mitigation hero upgrades.
The version of Marvel Dice Throne we've been playing is the Scarlet Witch, Spider-Man, Thor, and Loki 4-player set published by The Op, who we have to thank for hooking us up with a review copy. This Marvel Battler was designed by the team of Gavin Brown, Nate Chatelier, and Manny Tremblay. Features artwork from Manny, as well as Damian Mamoliti.
Dice Throne started as a series of games published by Roxley Games. The original features fantasy tropes, whereas this licensed Marvel version, which is published by The Op, features Marvel superheroes. Marvel Dice Throne is compatible with the entire Dice Throne ecosystem.
This 4-hero box lets you play 2, 3, or 4 players with more if you own additional sets. Games taking about 15 minutes per player once you know the game. While the game mechanics here aren't heavy, each character is very different and features their own set of status effects, tokens, and rules, which gives it a bit of a learning curve each time you try a new character.
A Marvel Dice Throne involves players upgrading and battling their heroes through clever card play and dice manipulation, where they'll roll their dice and spend them to attack and defend against other heroes. You can fight one-on-one, play King of the Hill, or battle in teams.
One of the highlights of the game are the game trays organizers that are used to sort out each of the heroes and their components. You can get a good look at these in our Marvel Dice Throne unboxing video over on YouTube.
Yeah, the trays really are awesome, and they get people excited about the game as soon as they crack it open. Except for a small punch board on top, this game is ready to play right out of the box. And I love being able to just open it up and drop 4 boxes on the table and say, pick a hero. Mm-hmm.
Even the components inside the trays are top of the line. Each hero has their own unique playboard, a sideboard, a variety of tokens, a unique set of etched dice, a unique deck of cards of good quality, as well as separate pre-assembled dials for tracking combat points and health. Now, I will note there the standee that you find in each tray is only for adventures and missions. It's not something you're going to use during the base dice throne play.
The component quality really is top notch. And Mo's right. Being able to hand out those character boxes, like as soon as they hit the table, folks are excited. They want to open them up and play. It had that effect on me, I know.
Yeah, the rulebook's a bit floppy, but clear and very detailed. Very detailed. Detailed in the people obviously run dice thrown tournaments kind of way. I can be a bit to get through at first, and you're going to find yourself referencing back to the book quite often at first, especially when it comes to the various damage types. There's actually like a grid of damage types and how you can defend. Other than that, though, I was just a bit thrown off by the fact that all of the examples are for a hero that doesn't even come in the box I bought.
Well, with that, let's move on to an overview of how to play Marvel Dice Throne. We're going to start with a basic 1v1 two-player game.
You start by grabbing a hero box, opening it up, and setting all the stuff out in front of you. Unfold the hero board and place the sideboard next to it. You place your hero's status tokens onto the sideboard, shuffle your cards, draw four, set your health dial to 50, and set your combat point, or CP, dialed to 2. And note that some heroes have additional setups.
Now, each turn, you're going to start by getting 1 CP and drawing a card, though this is skipped for the first turn for the first player. You then get to play cards from your hand, spending the CP cost on the cards. Note, you can always discard cards from your hand to gain 1 CP if you do need more.
Most cards you play during this phase will be cards that get you additional CP or upgrade your character abilities. Upgrades are played right on your player board, covering up the old ability. You may also surprise your foes with action cards.
Next is the offensive roll phase, where you get to roll your dice up to 3 times. You then pick one of your abilities on your player board to activate. Each requires a different set of symbols on the dice, a set of the same number, or a short or long straight.
Now, assuming the resulting attack isn't undefendable or pure, your opponent gets a defense roll. Pick a defensive ability, roll the indicated dice, read off the ability to see how they're spent. Note, most defense rolls in this set in particular don't just reduce damage. Some don't reduce damage at all.
Now, next you get another chance to spend cards from your hand to improve your character, use additional actions, or what have you.
Some cards can also be played during the offensive role plays, interrupting and manipulating either your or the other player's dice. And when you're resolving that phase, make sure you leave time for your opponents to respond to your actions.
And that's where the rules get really detailed on the timing of everything. So refer back to that section if you do have a bit of a conflict there. Now, that's the basics. You continue doing this until one of the heroes is reduced to 0 health and the other player wins. The thing is, though, like many dueling card games, this is an exception-based game. Every character is unique, and they each have their own abilities and cards that can do all kinds of things that mess with the basic rules.
Spider-Man can turn invisible and defend against undefendable attacks. Thor can toss and retrieve his hammer. Scarlet Witch can steal other characters' abilities. Loki can set up illusions that make him very hard to hit, and way more.
When you play with more than 2 players, there's an extra phase where you roll a die to determine who you attack, which prevents folks from teaming up on any one player. You can play King of the Hill, or Last Player Standing, or with 4 players, you can play in teams. Teams share 1 health pool and can freely share information and strategy. And in team mode, you will find that you are using those dice manipulation cards to help your ally as much as you are to hinder your foes.
Now, when I first started introducing Marvel Dice Throne to people, I used to call it Superhero Yahtzee. And honestly, that's doing it a disservice. Well, yes, the basic dice rolling mechanic is the same one as Yahtzee. Take your dice, roll them, then re-roll a total of 3 times. And yes, you're trying to get sets, right? You're trying to get 3 of a kind, or you're trying to get 3 symbols, or you're trying to get 2 of the symbol and 3 of another. But that's honestly where the comparison ends.
Yeah, I told Mo he has to stop using that line because the phrase Yahtzee but with superheroes did not make me want to try this game out. I actively dodged it for a while. But when we finally got it to the table, I discovered there are tons of ways to mitigate the luck of the dice and that the game is actually fairly strategic.
Yeah, because honestly, just thinking of this as just a dice game is wrong because it's just as much a dueling card game and has a lot of similarities to living card games and trading card games. The cards are how you upgrade your characters, how you manipulate the dice, and depending on your character, can actually be the main source of your abilities, as I was surprised to discover the first time I played Miles Morales.
Yeah, I like the way the cards allow you to upgrade the powers on your player board, and there's some fun and really thematic card combos that can happen. Loki has a card that's Liar Liar, and then later on in the deck you find a card that's Pants on Fire, and you want to make sure you play them both in the same round. That amused me the first time I read it, you know.
So one interesting thing to note, as I've seen it discussed in many places, is that this is in no way a deck construction game. Despite the fact that all of the card backs are the same, which might give the opinion that, oh, well, why can't we just shuffle them around? They must be meant to be because, again, all the card backs are the same. There is no mixing and matching.
Yeah, which is honest. It's good and bad. I will say I did have the one worry of what if I accidentally mix my cards? But I did find that you can get cardless on the Roxley website. Now, the real highlight to me of Marvel Dice Throne is how thematic it is, how each character plays very differently from the other three. Now, I've only experienced these four, but with these four in particular, it's the way they actually fit, at least what I know of the Marvel comic heroes they're based on. And now these do seem to be based on the comic heroes, not the cinematic universe characters, which is also indicated by the artwork. And this honestly covers all aspects of the games. From the icon distribution of the dice, not even every character has the same number of different icons or distribution of them. The content of the hero's decks are all different. And then everyone has their own little set of status effect tokens that go on a sideboard and that can be put into play. And then, of course, there's the different abilities on each player board. Some characters, like, for example, Scarlet Witch can't defend. Like, she has a defense and it's going to let you do cool stuff, but it's not going to stop any damage. Whereas Miles Morales actually has two different choices where he can counterattack or try to block the damage.
Yeah, I know with my first game as Loki, it really felt thematic. The way he was messing with my opponent's skills, presenting illusions to dodge attacks, it really captured the vibe of the character.
Yeah.
Yes, I loved playing Loki. I enjoyed playing other players as well, but that first play with Loki is what won me over on this game. Like, I was dodging it, and I sat down and played, and I went, "Ooh, I really like this." All of the powers just felt on theme. They felt right. It was just very thematic and very fun and super asymmetric, as Mo was already getting into.
Yeah, because the problem, though, is that the asymmetry gives this game some unexpected weight. Like, it sounds like a fast and furious dice chucking battle game. And I think somewhere on the box, it even indicates it's a fast playing furious superhero battle. But I have seen this game bogged down with analysis paralysis. If you take your time to figure out the odds and play the angles and wait for those right combos, there's a lot of depth to be found in Marvel Dice Throne. Now, personally, I think that's a good thing, but it can really depend on what you want out of this game.
Yeah, this game can lead to some serious AP, particularly if you're playing with my daughter. Or me, I was guilty of it too. Like, you're sitting there thinking, do you push your luck and try and roll again, or do you settle for that power you can set off now? And if you are rolling again, which dice are you keeping and which ones are you rolling? And are you going to use that card to manipulate the dice? Or are you going to save that card for next round? And then after that, when you roll and it doesn't go the way you expected it to, you have to recalculate. So, yeah, it can take a minute, particularly when, you know, you're getting further on in the game and you're getting trounced. It could take you a minute to figure out what you want to do.
Now, another thing I do want to touch on, again, we already talked about the awesome game trays inserts, but I just want to mention that the component quality here is awesome. Like, it really is top of the line. Now, I bring this up because I know the company is talking about putting out a lower price point version of the game without any of the trays. And I honestly think this is a mistake. I think that would be the wrong move. The presentation of this game immediately sets the tone, the expectation, and the feel before you've even played. Every single person I've shown this game to has been wowed by it. This ranges from younger kids to my mother-in-law. They just see it and like, wow, this is nice. I think that presentation, that initial feeling, the obvious show of quality is going to drive people to want more. I know before I even played, I wished we had expansions. You can watch my unboxing video where I'm opening it going, yes, I need more of this. I hadn't even played the game. I hadn't even read the rule book yet, and I wanted more. Yes, the gameplay is solid. We'll get into the gameplay. And yes, we enjoyed the game. But that presentation just brings it to another level.
Yeah, after just one play, the urge to pick up additional characters, Marvel or otherwise, is real, and the Marvel Missions solo content sounds really interesting as well. Mm-hmm. This game could get expensive if you're not careful.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. The gotta have them all factor hit me hard with this one. Like Mo said, as soon as you put out those trays on the table, I was like, oh, there's more of these. We could pile more of them on the table to pick from.
Yep.
Now, I've been hearing good things about Dice Throne, like all versions, not just the Marvel version, for a number of years here, and I've been eager to check it out. So again, I got to thank the op for this opportunity, because this is an example of a game that not only met, but exceeded my expectations for it. I was really expecting a light, almost party game, a light superhero dice chucker. I was expecting superhero Yahtzee. I thought we were going to have a quick romp, not a super asymmetric and highly thematic superhero battle that does feel like two of my favorite heroes are fighting each other. It's the depth in Marvel Dice Throne that keeps me coming back and has me wanting to pick up more heroes. And I got to say, I'm really tempted by the new Marvel X-Men sets that came out to coincide with X-Men 97. I'm really tempted by these.
I very much want to get the X-Men sets. I want to play this game with more characters, and I'm usually the voice of reason.
Yeah, I agree with D there. It's fun with four characters, but more choices, more fun. Isn't that how it works?
Yeah, should be. Plus, you know what? We get more players. We can start playing 3x3. So if you're a Dice Throne fan, I don't see a reason not to pick up Marvel sets. Like, why not? Get this one, the four hero set, get the others, get all of them, get all eight new heroes. They're fully compatible with the rest of the line as a big draw, and I think that's awesome. And as someone who's only tried Marvel, I'm tempted to go the other way and pick up some of the other sets, because I got to say, having Loki take on Santa sounds pretty cool to me.
Yeah, I'm not sure on that one. How about Santa versus Thor?
Okay. Miles Morales versus Krampus. Come on. There's so many possible combinations. The Barbarian versus Scarlet Witch. Like, I want to play out these battles. Now, if you're not a Marvel fan, if you're a Marvel fan and you want a game that lets you battle your favorite heroes against one another, this is going to be a good choice. This is a solid battling 1v1 or team-based card and dice game. It can be played casually with a nice short play time when you're not trying to figure out every odd and you're just rapid fire playing cards and dice. Or you can take the time to learn each character's in and out and turn it into a meatier than expected contest.
I like that it's quick to teach and quick to pick up. Everything is really on those boards in front of you and it's easy to explain. But if it can be pretty strategic if you want it to be.
Yeah, I think the Marvel Dice Throne is a real gateway for people who might not be hardcore hobby gamers to find out about Dice Throne as a product line. While reading about other people's thoughts on this product and others in the line, I saw more than a few people who mentioned that they bought it because it was superheroes, because it was Marvel, yep, and then went on to buy all of the original Season 1 and Season 2 Dice Throne products. So,
yeah, I could see that.
Now, I know Deanna, what she needs is the DC version. We get a Batman in there and she'll be sold. I don't even have to ask. Now, I also think this is going to appeal to fans of that 1v1 dueling game, right? The generally dueling card games, fans of older games like Overpower versus System, I think are going to find a modern superhero battle game they can enjoy here.
Yeah, I know the art here is much better than Overpower. that's for certain. And I believe it's all original, unlike the comic panels used in Verse and its Marvel offerings. Plus, no deck construction or collecting to worry about. Get your character and go.
Yeah, if you're looking for a pure strategy, low luck battle, though, where you're going to outplay and outthink your opponent and do various maneuvers on the board, that's not what you're going to find here. Maybe there's some other miniature-based Marvel games out there or something else you might be interested in. Well, there are lots of ways to mitigate the randomness. It's not just Yahtzee, but you are still dealing with a deck of cards and dice, so you're going to have some randomness. Now, the same is also true if you want something cooperative. That does not currently exist in this box where you're all working on the same side. I admit a bit of confusion with the theming of this game, because why are these heroes all battling each other? I'm sure comic fans can come up with a reason, but if you do want to play these heroes together, check out the new Marvel Dice Thrones Missions, which was part of a recently very successful Kickstarter.
Yeah, I am super curious about those missions. They sound interesting, though I suspect I would rather pound on someone than play co-op.
Yeah,
I think the biggest benefit of missions for many, myself included, is going to be the solo play aspect, which you don't get without missions or adventures.
Yeah, and plus, if you don't want to wait for the Marvel-themed cooperative version, there is Dice Throne Adventures. Though I don't know the theming on that one or how well it'll tie in, but it is all fully compatible. Now, what really made Dice Throne for all of us, I think, is how thematic it is. Like, how playing Loki felt totally different from playing Thor, and playing the two of each other against each other felt like an actual battle between two brothers. Like, I honestly felt like we were playing through the Marvel Knights cartoon that's out there. Worth watching if you get a chance. What's a game you like due to the fact that its theme is tied in this well?
I don't know about you, but that review left me a little parched. I can really use a coffee. Help keep us caffeinated and motivated by supporting the show through coffee. That's ko-fi.com/tabletopbellhop.
Or for those in the chat, just hit the link that just went by.
While Xylotar may have the most ridiculous theme we've ever heard, it's one of the best modern trick-taking games we've played, one that innovates by not letting you look at your own cards.
Xylotar was designed by Christopher Ray and is coming soon from Bezier Games, who we have to thank for hooking us up with an early review copy. It's a 2-5 player, rather unique, trick-taking game that plays in well under an hour.
Once upon a time, there was a polar bear with a Xylotar. And due to the events described in one very bizarre backstory, you are now trying to reassemble this wonky instrument by bidding for tricks.
In Xylotar, you play three hands of trick-taking where you will be bidding for tricks, but don't even get to look at your own cards, though you are going to be able to figure out their approximate value. The player with the highest score has found the perfect balance of 80s synthesizer rock and modern karimba melodies and is now ready to bring the Xylotar to the mass market.
Xylotar comes in a small card box and features 65 thinner-than-usual cards that come in 8 different colored suits. Each suit features cards numbered 0 to something, with the lowest suit being pink with 0 to 4, and the highest being red 0 to 11. Each suit also has an associated note with it to help tell them apart. There's also a set of very clear instructions and 5 high note cards.
When playing with 2, 4, and 5 players, you use all of the cards. When you play with 3, you remove 2 suits, and there's a set of variant rules for when you play with 2.
So you start a game of Xylotar by dealing out the cards evenly between all the players, who then sort the cards they were dealt from highest to lowest. They then place a high note card on the back of the stack and pass it to the next player. Yes, in this game, you get to look at one of your opponent's cards, all of them, their entire hand.
Each player takes the stack they were given and lays them out left to right, with the high note card going to the far left and each subsequent card placed beside the last. Note, no one gets to look at the cards they've been handed, but can approximate their values based on where they are placed and what suits they are dealt. To help with this, each card back lists the possible number range of the card on the back.
The player to the left of the dealer starts the hand by playing any card but their highest, which would be the one next to the high note card, and then everyone plays a card onto the trick with standard trick-taking rules applying. You have to follow suit if you can, and if you can't follow, you can play off suit. The highest card wins the trick, unless the trump suit, which is red unless you're playing with less players and it moves, is the highest red card plays wins the trick. The winner of the trick gets the next lead, and the hand ends when everyone has played all their cards.
Now, to make things interesting, if not seeing your own cards wasn't enough, at some point during each hand, players have to make a bid for how many tricks they'll take. But they don't get to just pick any number. To do this, they play a card, then they pick 2 cards in their current tableau that are adjacent to each other and look at them. One goes back, the other becomes your bid. This is the only chance you get in the game to look at your own cards.
At the end of each hand, players get 1 point per trick and then get 5 bonus points for hitting their bid. There's no penalty for missing it. You then play 2 more rounds, with a lead given to the player with the least points in round 2 and 3. At the end of 3 rounds, the player with the most points wins.
When you're playing Xylotar with 3 players, you take out the red and orange cards, and yellow becomes trump. For a 2-player game, you set up 2 ghost players, with the human players organizing the cards to their opponent and the ghost hand to their left. Your bids are set at the start of the hand by your center card. The ghost players always play their cards low to high based on suit, and if either hit their bid, neither player scores points for tricks. If both ghosts hit their bid, the humans don't even get points for hitting theirs.
So we discovered this game at the Gamma Trade Show where it couldn't be missed. That is because someone brilliant at Bezier Games actually made a Xylotar, one large enough for a polar bear to play. They had a true-to-scale, technically playable instrument there, one with lots of LED lights. The Bezier rep, Jay Bernardo, could often be found posing and walking around the floor with it.
Yeah, it was massive. I really should have grabbed a photo of the Xylotar. It was magnificent.
Now, this giant Xylotar and this silliness did nothing to prepare me for the most ridiculous theme in board gaming. A polar bear went to a concert in the 80s, which made them want a keytar, but they couldn't play one. So they worked with a local craftsman to invent the Xylotar. But then the craftsman went missing, and the authorities think the polar bear ate him. So the bear is now hiding in northern Canada under the northern lights. Come on, it's totally ridiculous, and honestly, has very little to do with the game.
It is easily the single most silly card game backstory I've ever heard. It's like someone let their five-year-old go wild and write the story.
Now, while ridiculous, it's also not easily forgettable. And the fact that we're here talking about the game tonight only reinforces that.
So ignoring the silly theme, what you're left with is a very cool and interesting, and I would say innovative, trick taker. Now, all of us here have played a lot of trick-taking games, including a growing number of modern hobby trick-takers. Reviews all over the blog of those and our YouTube channel. Each is trying to do their own thing, right? But this is nothing quite like anything else. This one's very unique. Now, of course, the big thing here is the hidden information. Now, one thing I'm not sure if it was clear from the overview of play is just how much information you do have. No, you can't look at your hand, but this isn't Hanabi, where you're going in completely blind. You can get a lot of information from just how your cards lay out. This is especially true if you have a suit without many numbers in it, a suit without many numbers in it high up on your track. Like if you've got a dark blue and spot 8, you know every card in your row from 1 to 7 has to be a 5 or less.
Yeah, you can make a lot of educated guesses based on how the cards are laid out. And as the game progresses, it becomes easier and easier to guess which cards you have. And also, you do get to peek at two of them when you place your bid.
Honestly, for how light a game this feels like it should be, there's a lot more to it for card counters and players who really want to figure out the card distributions based on what cards you gave other players, what's showing in front of you and in front of everyone else, and so on.
Yeah, and the key part there is the front of everyone else. There is a ton of information you can gain just by looking at other people's tableaus. Again, every cards are laid out on the table. No one's holding a hand. So honestly, looking at what your opponents have can be as important or even more important than looking at your own. This gives a real puzzle feel to Xylotar. I don't remember experiencing any other trick taker that felt like I was trying to solve a puzzle like this.
Yeah, that's true. I am not a card counter, and this game makes me want to count cards. You look at all the cards that folks have laid out on the table and paying attention to what they pull when they bid. And someone in the chat room was asking, do you get to see those cards? Well, what happens is you pull two and you will place one down face up in front of you as your bid, and you'll put the other one back and they won't see, but you will have seen that. And you're trying to remember what cards you just handed over to the player to your left. And all of that plays into trying to figure out what cards you have sitting in front of you and what you should bid.
I have to admit, especially after hearing the introduction to this game and the theme to the game, I was expecting a silly, frivolous trick taker based on that theming. But that is not what this is. In fact, it might even be heavier than what I want, especially when you consider the expectations the game sets with that silly theme.
Now, another thing I want to call about the game is that bidding system. I think it's actually brilliant. The fact you have to decide when to bid, and it's after you play, which is also important, and the fact bidding gives you a sneak peek at two of your cards is huge, and it's all part of solving that puzzle. Like, do you bid early so you know how hard you should be fighting for tricks or how much you want to give away to other players, or do you wait and play off the cards you know the values of, the ones that are blatantly obvious, and then use your bid to get that little extra piece of information mid-game that'll help you play out the rest of your hand. Plus, I like the way the scoring works, because you get points for every trick. So even when you don't hit your bid, you're still scoring points, and there's no penalty for bidding too high or too low.
Yeah, only getting 2 points for taking two tricks isn't so bad if it comes with a 5-point you got your bid bonus.
Yeah, the bidding thing is really interesting and really kind of twists this game a lot more than you would think it might.
Now, I did find the card design a little odd, but I did grow to like it. It's not the most striking, and things are different sizes and that. The sizes of the thin cards is nice. I do appreciate that. They're actually not bad to shuffle at all. I actually find them easier to riffle shuffle than a normal deck. The size of the notes, though, and the colors that follow your usual rainbow order, you know, your red, orange, yellow, green, blue, and even the note shapes all have actually helped me see the information I need to see at the table, which is really important for this one because you need to see the other player's tableaus. That open information is a big part of this game. And honestly, having real notes didn't matter to me at all. It doesn't matter that I have no idea what a sharp half note looks like. But I guess that's what the symbol is on those green cards.
Yeah, I liked the card size right where it was. The game already takes up a surprising amount of space. And if the cards were any larger, it would be problematic. I would say maybe they could have made a mid-twitch smaller, but then I would probably hate shuffling them.
Now, another thing I appreciate in Xylotar is the fact it's only three rounds. Most traditional card games and many modern card games fall into what I would call as a trap of making it so every player has to deal once. You play until everyone's the dealer once and the player to their left starts a round. That's so typical of card games. But that rule can make some fast-playing card games into long, almost epic game nights. They can be too long. And I'm pretty sure that's what would happen here. Well, I'm sure there's some card sharks out there that are frustrated because not every player gets to be dealer or they don't always get to lead. Maybe that leads to a lack of balance. But I like the fact that this game, to me, feels like it ends right when it's most interesting. Like, I've just had three rounds. I've had enough. Let's see who won.
I think, and for me, the three rounds is sort of a saving grace for me. And it prevents that game from overstaying its welcome. While it's fun, it's more of a card counter's puzzle than I personally enjoy. But that quick three-round format means you can enjoy the fun. I might not ask to play this, but I'm certainly not going to turn it down because I know it's not going to take up my whole night.
I'm actually really loving this game, but I agree, three rounds feels like just the perfect length.
Now, there is one problem with Xylotar, and Deanna kind of hinted at this earlier, that I think has to be brought up, and that is how much space it takes up. Due to the fact you are using the entire deck every game, that's a lot of cards to be displayed on the table at once. Eight is your middle card, so I think it's like 16 each if you're playing two players. Now, they did use thinner cards, but a full hand takes up a lot of room per player. At a regular rectangular table with two players per side, we've actually had to have players offset their cards so that at one point you're kind of overlapping. One player's cards are in front of another player's cards.
Yeah, unfortunately, you really need to see the cards, both your own and others' tableaus. So there are limits to how much you can condense things. And of course, the card order does matter a lot.
Overall, I was taken by my first play of Xylotar and I haven't looked back. I really dig the way this game plays. I like the way it makes me think. I love that feeling of accomplishment when I'm able to hit my bid. And I enjoy being surprised when I play a card expecting it to have one value and it being way off. Especially when you grab something way to the right and it's like a two. I dig the challenge of seeing a pink card come up by my high note card and trying to figure out how I can get any points. And that feeling of joy when I can take five tricks in a row by the end of the round, much to my opponent's surprise. I also enjoy being outplayed. And that feeling of hoping someone doesn't steal a trick I need, like, oh, they have the last trump. They don't need to take it, but maybe they will and screw me over. And that feeling of anticipation. Honestly, it's everything I love in a good trick-taking game.
Yeah, this one really scratches that itch for me. I love the way it makes me think. I like how easy it is to teach, though the way you stack the cards to hand them off can feel confusing to folks at first. They tend to pick it up pretty quickly. I actually think this is currently my favorite trick taker. Nice. I'm really digging it.
I honestly think this game is not being served well by its silly theme. This is a solid puzzle of a trick taker that will certainly engage people who love this sort of game. But in order to do so, they need to kind of get past the silliness that it really kind of throws at you up front, both on the box and in the rules.
Okay, point taken. But I'm just going to ignore the theme. It didn't turn me off from the game. It's just neutral. It's gone. It never existed. There's a polar bear on the front of the box.
I don't know. Maybe this is the one case where everyone tends to get mad at Mo for not explaining the theme of the game before we start playing. Maybe I should start skipping it. And even though it's amusing and it sticks in people's heads, I should just be saying, hey, you want to play a trick-taking game where you don't get to look at your own cards? Maybe that's the better way to sell it. I think if you dig trick-taking games, especially bidding games, right? It's things like spades, going back to traditional games where you're bidding for how many tricks you're going to take. I think you're going to love Xylotar, as long as you got a table big enough to actually fit it.
So I'm not sure it's as much of a blanket buy for trick-taking lovers as Mo thinks, but I definitely think it's worth a play to decide. I do think that it's a style of trick taker that may not be for everyone, as it's got that puzzle aspect to it.
Yeah, I actually think that's what I love, is that puzzle aspect. It's a trick taker where you can see what suits everyone has in play, and you can make an educated guess as to whether each card is high or low. And that makes for a pretty unique game versus your classic trick taker.
Okay, so looking at that way, I would say if you enjoy board games that present puzzles to be solved, I think this may be a trick-taking card game you would enjoy. Despite being a game where you can't even see your own cards, you are presented with a lot of information that lets you make those logical decisions. Now, as for everyone else, give this game a shot if you can. Honestly, at under $15, this could be worth taking a chance on. Just buy it, see if your group likes it, or maybe see if your local game store can do a demo night, or try it at a local public play event. Honestly, if anyone here in Windsor wants to give it a shot, just let me know. I'll bring it out to one of our events.
Well, that's all we have to say about Xylotar. Now that you know what that haunting synth karimba music that you sometimes hear when the northern lights are most bright is, it's time for you to tell us what game you've played that you think has the most ridiculous theme ever.
Leave a comment wherever you found this review, or better yet, let us know on the Tabletop Bellhop Discord at discord.tabletopbellhop.com.
Now, if you want to hear us talk about more oddly themed games like Xylotar, you can help keep the show going and keep us talking games by supporting us through Patreon. You can find that at patreon.com/tabletopbellhop. As thanks, you'll get access to things like first thoughts reviews, our show notes, some behind-the-scenes blog posts, bonus audio, and more.
You've just invented time travel. Where do you go and what do you do? This is just one of the many questions you could be tasked to answer in Kiss the Goblin, the alignment guessing party game.
Kiss the Goblin is a Dungeons & Dragons alignment-based card game that came from the mind of Tony Tran. It was published last year by Skybound Tabletop, who we do have to thank for providing us with a review copy.
Kiss the Goblin plays two-day players, with the questions being pretty family-friendly, though the answers may vary as far as that goes. A round of the game only takes a minute or two, but a full game could take up to an hour if you play to the recommended 12 points. But, I mean, who plays a party game for points anyways?
Right. So Kiss the Goblin's a party game built around the 9 Dungeons & Dragons alignments, made popular by countless 3x3 grid memes. Each round, you get a random alignment and then draw a card from the deck and answer the question as someone with that alignment. Other players then guess what alignment you are, and everyone who's right gets points.
Physically, Kiss the Goblin comes in a rather thick but small box that holds 115 prompt cards, 8 sets of 6 alignment cards, 20 double-sided tokens, and the short and simple game rules.
So it was somewhat surprising in that what you won't find here is any artwork, not even on the box. You have cards with borders, with text, and sometimes a banner on the top, and the font choice could have been better. They went with a calligraphy look, even though not all of the game's questions are fantasy-based.
Now, I know we've already given everyone a gist of how you play, which covers almost everything. Are there any other details worth pointing out in this game?
Well, your alignment cards are broken into 2 sets. You've got good, neutral, evil, and then a second set of lawful, neutral, and chaotic. You're going to draw a card from each set to determine the actual alignment you have to act out. Now, the other thing of those banners, when you're drawing a prompt card, some have a banner at the top where you're going to source the table. It'll say something like animal. So what you do is go, hey, everyone name an animal, and you're going to pick an animal, and then you're going to include that animal in part of the question. Other than that, there's the official scoring rules, which is if even one person guesses your alignment, you get a point, and then everyone who got it right also gets a point. First player to 12 points wins the game.
And the game also includes a special cooperative 2-player mode. In this case, you just go back and forth and are trying to get a string of correct guesses in a row, with 3 guesses in a row being great and 7 showing that you really know your partner.
So yeah, dead simple. Get an alignment, answer a card, everyone guesses, get points, done.
Yeah, that was it. And when I first read that, I thought it was going to be too simple. It sounded boring. I read it and thought that this is it. This is the game. This is someone published. This is a full game. I'm not going to enjoy this. I was immediately ready to start making the game more detailed and more involved, coming up with all kinds of ideas on house rules. But then we played it with Brenda and the kids, and it was a huge hit.
Yeah, I did not expect this. I was blown away. It was so much fun. Everyone at the table got it, even my mom, who didn't really know the D&D alignments, despite the fact she played Red Box way back in the day. The kids didn't really know the alignments either. But everyone got it. Everyone enjoyed it. Everyone was laughing. Jenna was almost falling on the floor laughing. She said it was one of her favorite games ever. It was super fun. And yeah, it was totally enjoyable.
Yeah, and what I missed reading the rules, I think, was just coming at it as a hobby gamer, right? Like, it's the simplicity of the rules that made it work. How quick it is, how rapid fire, how you're answering a question, everyone's laughing, going, "What? What do you mean you picked good? How is that good?" And someone justifying it and then moving around. It doesn't need any added rules, more complexity. It doesn't need deduction. It just needs a quick, simple game. It's meant to be a silly, fun party game, and it works as a silly, fun party game.
Yeah, and it just works. This game is way more fun than it has any right to be.
Well, as with many party games, it's the players and what they put into it that really make it fun. The cards, the rules, they're just a light framework for corralling players into while everyone's having fun.
Yeah, and honestly, since the first game with family, I've had Kiss the Goblin out at public play nights, where it was also a big hit. Yeah, sometimes the first couple rounds are a bit rough, but once people get it, they really get it, and the laughs start.
And I know Gwen has taken this one out to the board game club at her school, and it's been a hit there as well.
Now, the only real downfall here is the fact it's the 9 D&D alignments, which people may or may not know. And if people don't know these from the game or from the memes, most people I've taught nowadays actually just know the 9x9 memes with the different alignments under them. It's going to be a little rough, at least getting into the game. Now, the instructions do give you an alignment grid with samples for every combination. And in the back of the book, even gets into the two axes of the alignment system and kind of explain why it's that way. So there is something there to get players started. But I found once you get around the table once, like with a 5-player game, once everyone's gone once, everyone kind of gets it. Especially with that after round discussion on why did you pick this, that tends to get people to get a good idea in their hand what each alignment means. And still, it is always subjective. This is a party game. There are no right or wrong answers.
Yeah. The chart in the book is helpful. I wish the game came with a reference card for the alignments, something to put out on the table, or better yet, something for each player to reference. I'm tempted to print something up and put it in the box.
It certainly does help that D&D is much more in the public eyes these days as well. Yeah. Its concepts are much more mainstream than we've ever seen before.
Now, I do want to note that the D&D basis is important. This is not an official licensed D&D product. Nowhere on here are you going to see the words Dungeons and Dragons, probably because Hasbro would be very upset at it. This is a Dungeons and Dragons themed product based on the alignment system from the world's most popular role-playing game. But the other thing to note, though, is don't expect D&D questions. When I first got this, being Kiss the Goblin, I actually thought it was going to be fantasy-based. And actually, I would say probably most of the questions aren't. Like, I remember one question being about a cab driver and your fare running off, what do you do? And another one where you show up to game night and your friends won't get off their phones and play the board game, what do you do?
Yeah, the first time we played this, the first few questions felt like the game was reality-based. But then you do get to ones that include time travel and superpowers and wizards and, well, goblins.
Ooh, superpowers. Why have I not played this yet?
There you go. Now, despite having fun with the game as it is, I got to say, there's still a part of me. There's just a small part of me that wants to gamify it more. I want it to be a deduction game. Like what I expected was everyone gets dealt out an alignment and they're all different. So each one of us would have a different alignment and we'd all be answering the same question or same set of questions. And then people would vote because then you get the deduction of, well, they're not obviously evil. That means someone over there must be. That's kind of what I wanted. I still think there's a solid set of house rules that could be put into this game to bring it to that level. But honestly, that's not what we're here to review. Game in the box, just fun how it is.
Yeah, the game as is surprisingly solid. Though, if you want to get into house rules, Gwen and I were talking about a mashup of this and Dubious, where you use the cards from Kiss the Goblin as the questions for Dubious, and it could be cool.
I could see it.
Board game mashup.
As a silly D&D alignment themed party game, Kiss the Goblin does exactly what it's meant to be that silly fun that gets people interacting, talking, and laughing together. I think it's a great gateway game, and due to the nature of the game, it's also a good icebreaker or get-to-know-each-other game. If you're on the hunt for a new party game, especially if your regular group are or were into D&D, you should consider picking up Kiss the Goblin.
I think fans of improv games or theater games will love this. I could certainly see teachers picking up this game to use in drama classes, representing, you know, teaching kids how to represent a character.
For everyone else, I'm sure you can make up your own mind based on this review. Just be sure not to dismiss the game out of hand because it seems like it's too simple and is only scratching the surface on what can be done in a D&D alignment-based game. This ended up being one of its features and not in any way a downfall.
Well, you've gotten to the end of a Kiss the Goblin review. You are about to leave a comment on the review to let the world know what you think about the game. What do you write?
No matter your alignment, you can share your thoughts by commenting here, hitting us up on social media under Tabletop Bellhop one word, or sending me an email, mo@tabletopbellhop.com.
Well, that was the double bell.
That means it's time to go home. Our shift's coming to an end, and we're going to have to lock up the lobby doors for the night.
Before we start locking things down, let's take a moment to thank a selection of our Tabletop Bellhop Patreon patrons.
Danielle and Owen Thomas, thank you.
Sean P. Kelly, thanks, Sean.
Derek Hissen, thanks, Derek.
Thank you to the members of the Misdirected Mark Gaming Podcast.
Donna, thanks, Pax.
Evil John, thank you, John.
Now, even when we're not here live, you can always find us at tabletopbellhop.com, all over the web as Tabletop Bellhop, one word, and on your podcatcher of choice as the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
If you dig what we've been doing, help keep us going by becoming one of the Tabletop Bellhop Patreon patrons, like we just called out. That group of awesome folk gets access to first thought reviews, our pre-production show notes, bonus audio, and more.
That's all for tonight, folks. You can also support us by giving us a thumbs up, a like, leave a comment, or better yet, tell your friends and fellow gamers about our show.
Or the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast. I'm Sean.
I'm Deanna.
And I'm Mo.
Thank you.
And game on.